A lot of us would have learned at school that the Romans invaded Britain in AD 43. And while this is true, it suggests that this is the beginning of the Roman story in Britain, rather than the culmination of almost a century of Romano-British exchange, starting at least as early as Julius Caesar's expeditions into Britain in 55 and 54 BC. In this video, curators Julia Farley and Richard Hobbs will discuss five archaeological finds and investigate Britain before and after the Roman invasion.
When we look at the archaeological evidence from the first century BC, we see communities in southern Britain getting closer and closer relationships with the Roman world. What I'm standing next to here is a reconstruction of a burial from the late first century BC, so perhaps a generation after Caesar's expeditions into Britain, but decades before the conquest. So what are these doing here? These are imports from northern Italy that have come into Britain. And you'll see standing along the back here, five amphorae. Now, these are something that we more typically associate with the Roman world, but this burial was actually found at Welwyn Garden City. And the reason why the people might have been importing that material is because they were using connections with Rome and connections with the Mediterranean to show off their wealth and status. So importing all of this nice Italian wine to drink and having all of the equipment that you need to drink it in something a bit like the Roman style might have been a way to show how powerful and important and well connected you were. Some of the other objects here that this man was buried with might have been imported too. One of them is this white flagon here, which might have been used for serving drinks like wine. And another is this silver cup, which is probably used for drinking wine. Right at the front here, we have something that we call a strainer that works a little bit like some teapots that you might have today, which have a strainer behind the spout. And this is used for mixing and serving wine. The wine that they're serving at this time, they might be doing something a bit more like mulled wine. You're not pouring it straight from the amphora into your glass and drinking it. You're heating it up with spices and herbs and then pouring it out. But you don't necessarily want to pour those herbs and spices into your glass. And so this is probably an imported Roman vessel, but after it arrives in Britain, it's been changed and augmented with these extra little fittings that allow it to be used as a strainer vessel. And the strainer plate itself, that little sieve, is decorated with swirling Celtic art design. Many of the other things in the burial might actually have been made in Britain, but they're still copies of Roman or a Gaulish ways of serving up food and drink. The way that you have a fabulous dinner party in late first century BC Britain is to eat and drink like the Romans do. And that's how people are showing off their connections. So what are the local people of Britain trading for all of these wonderful imported Roman goods and this northern Italian wine? We have some accounts from the classical authors, Roman writers, who tell us that things like corn and hunting dogs and even slaves are being exported from Britain. But the Romans are also aware, clearly, that Britain is very rich in natural resources, things like metals, you have tin and lead. And it may be desire to get their hands more directly on some of those natural resources that it causes some of the reasons for the actual boots on the ground conquest of AD 43.
So this lead ingot bears a stamped inscription which tells us two things. Firstly, that the ingot is derived from lead found in Britain. And secondly, that it belongs to the Emperor Nero. Mineral resources were one of the key reasons why the Romans invaded Britain in the first place, because it was known to have good mineral resources. And it's no accident that within 10 years of the invasion in AD 43, the Roman army was in control of the Mendips lead mines, which are around the area of Bristol in the West Country. Lead was also found in the Pennines and the Peak District and parts of Wales. Lead was obviously important in its own right as a mineral resource. For example, it was used for lead pipes. It was also used to make objects like tableware. But also lead was found with silver. And analysis of this particular ingot has shown that the silver had been extracted during the production process. So the silver obviously was of huge importance as alongside the lead itself. This lead pig also bears another inscription, which is the name C. Nippius Ascanius. Now, he was someone who would have been a lessee, someone basically licensed to do mining. And this was one way in which the Roman administration operated. They basically granted licenses to people to extract metals, and he would have been in charge of, no doubt, a number of slaves who would have done the mining. It was very unpleasant and dangerous work. And there was a high mortality rate in any of the mining regions in the Roman Empire. To be sent to the mines was certainly something considered to be a punishment. Interestingly, this particular individual is later named on another lead pig found in Wales during the time of Vespasian, which is a little bit later. So it shows that he was still operating as a lessee later on during this period. Now, this particular ingot weighs a hefty 73.5 kilograms. Now, this equates exactly to 230 Roman pounds. One of the key legacies of the Roman occupation of Britain, and indeed the rest of the empire, is the standardization of weights and measures. And things like coins and metals and so on are regularly found to conform to quite precise units of measurement. Now, another important metal that Britain was known for was tin, particularly from the West Country, for example, in Cornwall. Tin was very important because it was one of the main components of bronze, which is an alloy of tin and copper. Why was it so important? Well, bronze was one of the key metals used for the Roman military to make things like arms and armour. And so that's why the tin resources of Britain were so important to the Romans.
This is the Merrick helmet. It was probably found somewhere in northern Britain. And if you look at it closely, it's actually got some very interesting patterns and designs and decoration. We often think of helmets as being quite a functional piece of armour, but they're doing a lot more than that as well. If you look at the very, very top of the helmet, you can see a mark and a hole where once there would have been a crest or here, perhaps a plume, something like that. Down the side, we see areas where there were once cheek pieces fixed there, which have just the beginnings of some swirling decoration that we can see. And around what's actually the back of the helmet, this is the neck guard, you're looking at what might be intended to look a little bit like a carry handle for this helmet, but is in fact just a little piece of repoussé decoration picked out in the sheet of the helmet neck guard with beautiful swirling designs. Now, the form of this helmet is very Roman. Roman legionaries and auxiliaries in the first century AD would all have been wearing helmets just like this one. But the decoration isn't Roman at all. The decoration with these swirling designs and insets of red glass, where you see those textured areas on the back of the helmet, that's where red glass insets would have been fixed on. These are elements of design that are really calling on pre-Roman British art, what today we call Celtic art. So whoever commissioned this helmet, or had it made, or had it decorated, has chosen a helmet that's a Roman form, but decorated with much more Iron Age pre-Roman style British art. And that perhaps makes us wonder who might have been wearing and using a helmet like this. Is this somebody from the Roman army? Is this an indigenous Briton? There's another little clue on the helmet that might help us answer that question. If we look at the side, towards the right-hand side of the back of the helmet, there is a little engraved Roman numeral 2. And so that implies that somebody who was using this helmet, perhaps, you know, labelling it, is this the equivalent, if several people have similar helmets, of having the name tag in your clothes when you're at school? It's a way of marking out this particular helmet. And obviously there's an element of perhaps literacy or at least numeracy there with whoever's done this. And that's pointing us to a little bit more towards the Roman world, perhaps. So is this a helmet that's being worn by a Roman legionary or a Roman auxiliary? Perhaps, but if it is, they have commissioned it in a very local British style. And this is helping us to answer some of these questions that we have, I think, when we wonder about, you know, what people were wearing into battle in the conquest of Britain or in something like the Boudiccan Revolt, where we have people on the Roman military side fighting people on the indigenous British side. And the kit that they were wearing and using might actually have been quite similar. And that's partly because military kit is quite widely shared at this kind of time. People tend to see things and pick up on ideas and designs. It's the kind of technology that travels quite far and quite fast. But also, people are taking inspiration from what they see. If this is a Roman legionary, then this is somebody who wants, they're serving in the province of Britannia, and they want to emphasize that in their battle kit. They're not trying to look distinctively Roman, non-British, they're trying to actually look like they belong in the province of Britannia. And this is part of what we see in the first century AD and beyond, that we're not looking at Britain just becoming Roman, like there's some kind of cookie cutter template for what it is to be Roman. We're actually looking at the people of Roman Britain, many of whom will never have been to Rome, creating a new way to be, a new kind of identity, which is distinctively Romano-British and draws on elements from the Mediterranean world, from other parts of the Roman Empire, but also on elements from Britain and traditions in Britain from the pre-Roman time as well.
This tombstone was found in Lincoln, and is one of the earliest known from Roman Britain. It commemorates a soldier by name of Gaius Cepheus. Now, he was a soldier in the 9th Legion Hispana. We learn that Gaius Cepheus originated from Heraclea, which is in modern-day Macedonia. We learn that Gaius Cepheus died at the age of 40 after 22 years' service. Given that he died around about AD 60, he may have been caught up in the events known as the Boudiccan Revolt. Now, this was the only really major uprising against Roman rule. This is one of the earliest tombstones known from Britain. It's also part of what we call the epigraphic habit, which is basically writing on stone, writing on monuments, and recording important details, obviously in Latin. And one of the biggest legacies of the Roman period in Britain is, of course, writing itself. There is very little writing that we get before the Roman period. The only writing that we have in the Iron Age, the period that precedes it, is on some Iron Age coins.
After the boots-on-the-ground Roman conquest of Britain in AD 43, we see some really dramatic changes in what's happening in southern Britain, and these would have had a big impact on local populations there. So we know already that some of these people had had quite close connections with the Roman world, even before the actual conquest. But that had always been on their terms. We're talking about trade and exchange, people travelling and moving around. What happens after the military annexation of Britain is really different. And we see this perhaps most clearly in Colchester. Colchester had previously been an indigenous capital called Camlodunum. And this was an important place where the local elites lived and ruled from. But after the invasion, a Roman city is instead set up on this site. And this is what's called a colonia. So after the Romans conquer a province, they settle it in part with veterans. And this is what we see at the colonia of Colchester. We know there are a lot of veterans living here, and they also will have been bringing their families with them, perhaps settling down, perhaps getting married, starting to transition into normal civilian life. But what we're seeing in terms of the architecture of Colchester is like nothing that the indigenous inhabitants of Britain would ever have seen before. In pre-Roman Britain, people are living mostly in thatched wooden roundhouses. They live in fairly small villages or perhaps slightly larger settlements, sometimes with earthworks like a hill fort. But what we're looking at here really is a proper Roman town. It has stone-built architecture, and it also has a large temple to the deified Emperor Claudius, who's now died. And this is something which would just have looked completely out of place to the indigenous inhabitants of Britain. And Tacitus, writing about it later, calls it an alien stronghold of Roman rule, describing how it must have looked to the local people. So there are going to be tensions here, and this really comes to a boil at the time of the Boudiccan Revolt. After Boudicca starts rallying her troops, and this is in AD 60 or 61, she sets out to make a mark against the Romans, and she chooses to do this by attacking this blatant stronghold of alien rule at Colchester. So her forces ride on the colonia and raise it to the ground. There's evidence of deliberate fire setting and burning, and the whole city is decimated. Archaeologically, we can start to see traces of this. in places like Colchester and later London, which Boudicca attacks later, we see something called the destruction layer. And this is a thick black layer of soil from the burning of these cities. In Colchester, excavations in 2014 were looking at this destruction layer in Fenwick's, the department store, the foundations there. And immediately under that destruction layer, just below this area of burning, they found a hoard of jewellery. And this is now known as the Fenwick hoard. When you look at this, you'll see really two different sets of material. So we've got some gold jewellery, rings, earrings, and bracelets. And these would have belonged to a woman. And we also have some silver jewellery, specifically some arm rings or armillae. And these would have belonged to a man. We think that this is the jewellery, the kind of, you know, joint treasure, if you like, of a Roman couple, probably a man and wife, who lived in Colchester at the time of the Boudiccan Revolt. And they have taken their most treasured, their most valuable possessions, and they've buried them in the floorboards, probably, of their house, or just tucked them away somewhere to keep them safe, probably then going to the temple or seeking safety somewhere else. They never come back to collect these objects. We can't say for certain what happened to them, of course, but it's most likely that they died in the temple, probably, and certainly as a result of the Boudiccan destruction of Colchester. So what do we know about these people? We can look at the armlets that would have belonged to the man, probably a veteran, and start to see some of the designs here. This is the equivalent of getting a medal in the Roman army. These are probably awarded for bravery, so not everybody would have had these. There's a suggestion here possibly that this man would have risen above just the rank of legionary, that he might be quite important. The most complex, the one with these hinged sections, does have a specific decorative design, and that emphasises this military connection. We see here in the central panel the figure of Jupiter flanked by Victory, with an obvious military connection, and also Fortuna, the goddess of fortune or good luck. And that's a common military motif. Around the sides is a hunting scene with panthers, which is another probably, you know, kind of masculine connotation here. What about the other jewellery? What about this gold jewellery? These would have belonged to a woman, and the closest parallels for a lot of these actually come not from anywhere else in Britain, but from Pompeii. And there are depictions and jewellery from that first century AD Italian world of women wearing very similar jewellery to this. So either this is a woman who wants to dress like she's Italian and from the Mediterranean, or most simply and straightforwardly, this might be the Italian wife who's moved to Britain of this veteran.
To find out more about the Roman Empire during the reign of Nero, check out our latest exhibition, Nero, the Man Behind the Myth. Details are on your screen now.